Hello, everybody. This is the one and only Mr. LP, Steven Sykes, here with Enliven Radio, part of the Great Legacy Internet Radio. I have here part of our empowerment series, the one and only Miss Tiffany Lynch. How are you doing today?
I'm good, thank you.
You enjoying the winter season and enjoying all the holiday festivities?
Yes, I have. I have been enjoying the winter season. It's been awfully cold the past couple of days. Yeah, I've been enjoying that.
No problem. Well, Ms. Lynch, tell us a little bit about this yourself. Where are you from?
I'm actually from Martinsville, Virginia. It's Southwest Virginia. Yeah,
No problem. Well, and then down there, you went to a great and wonderful high school that's well known. And what's the name of that high school?
Yes, the high school that I went to, the name of it is called Laurel Park High School.
Okay. Now, growing up in Martinsville, granted, for those who don't know, it's a small world, and probably giving it a little bit too much, but it's a small world town. And for you, how was it growing up as a young black female in the area and just trying to find yourself? How was your feelings towards that?
Growing up in a small town, Martinsville, Virginia, for me was actually a great experience. I guess I would have to say, I don't think that I went through too many trials and tribulations. I think maybe it was my upbringing from my parents, but I definitely look back on how I was raised, and I think it has a big part in who I am today. I would never change. I would never change how I grew up, the area, the small town, everyone know everyone type of feel. I actually miss that. Being away and living, in a major city now. But growing up in a small town, actually, it was good in a way. Moving away, it kind of shows you how sheltered you can be, because like nowadays you meet people and they can kind of tell you anything. In our hometown, it was so small. People really just couldn't get away with telling big lies because someone knew someone. And you always had that sense of security of someone knew someone's mother or someone knew someone's cousin. So it's like, it was kind of like, what is the saying? Takes a village to raise a child. I really feel like when I think of Martinsville, that's what I think of.
What type of things did you get involved in? Like, did you have any other siblings? And, well, what did your parents, what type of raising style that your parents were? Were they harsh, mean, or nice?
I was the third born. I have two older sisters. And I think just being in that birth order of being the baby of the family, of three girls, my parents were definitely probably tired and worn out. So I think I definitely was treated like the baby, which means I probably got away with a lot more than my older siblings. My parents, their parenting style was very relaxed. I think that most people on the outside looking in probably thought that my parents let me do whatever I want. But my parents were laid back. We had a very open communication, and we had discussions about things that I wanted to do. One of my mother's main things I remember her always telling myself, and I remember her and my father saying, was that she wanted her kids to always have the opportunity to try different things and to put us in a place where we can at least say we've tried things. So the parenting style was pretty laid back. I did get to speak up and voice my opinion. We didn't always agree about things, but my mother always put me in a situation where I could say that I did try it. So, and she did the same thing for my sisters. So we've always been very active. And I remember starting out with swimming lessons to dance lessons. And one thing my mom always said was, if we start something, we finish it. So if it was something that I told her that I wanted to do, whether it be soccer or karate or anything, while in the middle of it, if it was something that I said, oh, I don't like this anymore, you can't stop it. You have to finish it. You don't go back to it if you don't like it, but you must complete what you start. And I think that was a strong foundation, for my mom and my dad telling me those things.
What type of things did you do? You said you did karate, soccer. What other activities did you participate while you was in school?
When I was in school.
Yeah, I know these answers, but I gotta.
And actually, well, I started out before, well, actually starting out, I played no sports or anything at first. I only did gymnastics and dance from like kindergarten all the way to 7th grade. I actually went to the city schools from kindergarten until 6th grade. I then
What?
moved, well, I moved schools to the county, even though I always lived in the county. And I was asked to play intramurals one morning in 7th grade, and I played. And some of the females asked me if I would play on a rec team. Never played on a rec team. Never thought about playing on a rec team. So they told me to come to tryouts. I went to tryouts. After tryouts was over, I made the team. My mom told me that I would have to choose between basketball or gymnastics and dance because they ran into each other on the same days. I chose basketball and I left the dance and gymnastics alone, which was very different for me. Even though I came from a small town, the two sports that I did before, not to bring race into it, but I was usually one of our two of black people in my class. So in dance and gymnastics, it was usually me and maybe one other black girl. And the same thing like with gymnastics. So when I started to when I tried out for basketball, it was different for me. But I had a good time doing it. I made the team. I chose that sport. The next year, I went to 8th grade. And I was asked to play on the JV basketball team for the high school team. So after I was asked to do that, I accepted. I was kind of, I still went to school with my peers in 8th grade, but it was different because I had to ride the bus over to the high school to practice with older girls. So I always hung out with my peer group, but I always had that when it came to sports. I was usually a level above, but that was fun in itself. I wasn't new to basketball. It was just the first time me playing organized basketball. I have two older sisters who are very good in basketball and sports at the same high school. So I already knew the coach. I had been a ball girl, a mascot cheerleader, So I was very familiar with the high school and known for being the little sister of Carrie and Kim. So me just playing was just that, just kind of a norm for our family. And that's how I started into the sports at Laurel Park. And usually when you play basketball, they want you to play like a spring sport. So when they asked me to play, I played soccer before. But I think the basketball coach, one of the assistant coaches, she coached softball. So she asked me to play softball. And I did that. And I was the starting pitcher. I was actually good at fast pitching. They showed me how to do it. And I caught on very fast. I can honestly say that I really don't like anything else but pitching. Like, I really didn't like hitting. I didn't really like doing anything else. But I don't remember how well we did that year. But I enjoyed it. I gave it my all. And I played some other sports. I don't know if you want to know about those,
Hell, you
but
can tell it all.
okay. So the next year, again, I played basketball. Track was one thing that I never wanted to do. I never liked running, where a lot of my other basketball teammates, usually ran track or they did cross country. So when I got to the high school in 9th grade, I started as a freshman as the point guard. for the varsity team. And what I did in the off season was I chose to play soccer. I want to say that was the first year that I think they created a women's soccer team for our school. We had only had guys soccer. So I was really excited about that. And I think maybe myself and maybe one other female from the basketball team played. And everyone else pretty much, my other friends, they ran track and did stuff like that. But I did do that, and I did play volleyball. So in volleyball, my position was a setter. I was still a point guard on the basketball team. And soccer, I was all over the place. It was created new for females at our school. So we all just kind of found out what we were good at. And we kind of just had fun with it. And I didn't have a particular position that I was better at. We just actually had fun with it. Can't even remember how the season went. Don't know how well we were, but I just know we were totally excited about it. And that was pretty much the sports that I participated in while in high school at Laurel Park, which led me to go to college. And I play basketball and volleyball in college.
Okay, a couple of questions. Who's a better sports athlete in your family?
Wow. I'm going to be honest, totally honest with you.
I'm going to tell them too. I just want to let you know.
Yeah, I don't mind if you tell them. My older sister, Kim, I was so young when she played. I don't really remember. I would say for her, she's the most well-rounded as far as she was track and field. She did volleyball. She did basketball. Closer to me would be my middle sister, Carrie. I really looked up to her and how she played, her aggressiveness. I would say my style is a lot more like hers. So I guess, if it were up to me, I would say my sister, Carrie, is like probably the better basketball player. I know she spent a lot of time making her craft better in basketball. I actually spent a lot of time with her practicing on and off. I probably maybe as much as her, but I don't think I put as much effort into it as she did. So I would say that I think that my sister Carrie really kind of went hard with basketball all the way around the board, if I had to honestly say. I also have a niece that was raised in my household, and her name is Brittany. And I would have to say basketball has changed dramatically. Back when I played and back when my sisters played, there was a time where you get the ball, you set yourself up and you take your shot. Maybe about 6 years ago, it may have been 5 years ago, I tried to play a game of pickup with my niece, Brittany, and the game has totally changed. They passed me the ball on a fast break, and it felt like I was going very, very fast. And before I knew it, some of her teammates had caught up with me, and it wasn't so easy doing that fast break to a layup. And I didn't get down there as fast. And I just see that the girls move a lot differently. They shoot off of the run like the guys used to, where girls didn't do that at one point in time. So, I really have to say, now I said that my sister's good, I really have to take my hat off to Brittany, because I was away in college when she came into her, came into her greatness of basketball. And I actually was like, oh, okay, she's okay. But when I went and actually saw her play, like I really had not really acknowledged how good she was. And I honestly have to say, probably I have to take back what I just said. Brittany is probably our star athlete out of the family. I have to give her that. She's dynamic.
I'm staying neutral in all of this because I played against all of y'all.
Right. Yeah, yeah.
And all of y'all can beat my tail, so I have no problem saying.
Yeah.
What did sports do for you growing up at that time? Would you say growing up in terms of like you coming along as a woman? Did it give you the confidence that you needed? Did it help give you bring out something that you did not have, or improve something that you already had and took it to a next level?
You know, I think sports altogether, and you know, I just went through something recently, you know, a couple of weeks ago, as what you just asked me, like, what did it bring out in you? I was just telling someone that when I played sports, we were very traditional, as far as, you know, we had to shake hands. We were not allowed to boo other players. We were taught fundamentals, basic fundamentals. And the biggest thing that we were taught was teamwork. And you know, and that goes a long way in life even now, with everything I do. Now with work, with whatever I do, I usually try to make it a team effort, because everyone plays a part, from the person on the bench to the person that scores the most points, to the person that's, you know, the most defensive. And how I think that sports impacted me and helped me was definitely, yes, it helps your confidence level. And it just teaches you that you're better, that you can, you're only as strong as your leader, who was your coach, and everyone plays a part. And to kind of respect everybody, you know, and I've been around some people recently, you know, and there was some issues with, you know, not being a team player. And it just kind of dawned on me, you know, that, you know, when I was talking to them, they had never played a team sport, and just naturally in everything I do, I look at how everyone can contribute, or everyone can play a part, or how, you know, you may not be the best writer, but how can we just bring this together? And I just think anytime when you participate on a team and you have a good basis, a good coach, it says a lot. And I didn't realize how, like, and I'm going to take you way back, but back when he played, everyone was going to wear the same sneaker. Mm-hmm. You couldn't wear a different sneaker. And I know a lot of people now, they don't even remember those times, but that showed like the togetherness of the team. I remember, like, not maybe until my senior year, I think my coach let me and another player wear a pair of Jordans. But, you know, for all those other years up until then, you know, you couldn't wear a black pair of sneakers, or when the black socks came out, you did what the team did, you know? And I just think that we've gotten away from that. And I'm just glad that I was able to experience that, and just to experience, you know, teamwork, you know.
That's one of the things I can honestly say with you, or just the women at home, is the level of strength and togetherness that we enjoyed. And that was something that was very important to me. Yes. What would you say, and here's a tricky one, what would you say how race relations were in Martinsville, or particularly in high school? Because it's really different than, I could say, anywhere else. And how would you describe it?
This subject has come up a lot with me, with new people that I've met that are not from where I'm from. Mm-hmm. I definitely know where I come from. It is a racist place. For some very odd reason, I escaped that, and I have not ever had to deal with it, which is so odd.
Compared to anywhere else. Yeah,
compared to anywhere else. And I don't know why, and I don't know if it was just some blessing from God, but the high school that I went to, in my opinion, the majority of the black people that were there, to me, they were just as smart. Equally, I felt like, you know, justice was due. I can't remember exactly. Our valedictorian was black. You know, I felt like everything was fair, unless I missed something that wasn't going on. But just like there were some different class levels of people,
right,
economically. I felt like there were just as many underprivileged African Americans as there were underprivileged white Caucasians. And I've never actually been treated differently because of my race that I've noticed.
That's the thing I have trouble explaining for those who don't understand. I can say the same thing in many of us. Everything was pretty fair. I think, if anything, I felt maybe some of the black teachers, people were maybe harder on us than some of the others. But if that was the case, it's because we needed it, because we were cutting up. It was something that everybody got along for the most part. Everybody had a problem. Everybody respected each other. I think, you hit the nail on the coffin, that it was more of a economic difference more than anything than social.
I totally agree. That's what it was. And like I said, I don't think that it doesn't go on. I just think that somehow, some way, I escaped it. And I do remember, I don't remember what high school it was, but I do remember someone saying that one of the other high schools, they did have like one homecoming princess that was black and one white homecoming. And we didn't have that. And so I always felt comfortable. I always felt like justice was always done. And I never felt that when there was a black person or African American that received an award, I never heard turmoil or anger from a Caucasian person.
Exactly. It was always very fair.
We all seemed to kind of get together. I mean, we were fine. As far as I knew, now I know some of maybe the classmates' parents, maybe felt differently about that. But, as far as how we were treated and how we got along, I can honestly say, when I talk to people now, I look back at my life and I look at Martinsville, and it's kind of like Leave It to Beaver. We didn't skip school. You couldn't skip school. I hear people saying, I used to skip school. If you skip school, in our hometown, first of all, someone's going to see you walking away from school. Someone's going to bring you back. People knew that you weren't supposed to be out of school if you were somewhere you couldn't be. So,
you can't hide.
I would never change how I was raised or anything about it.
You can't hide, though. Everybody knew where you were. Everybody knew where you were going. It's just stuck.
Yeah.
Where did you go to college?
I went to college 2 hours away from Martinsville. It was not a change at all from Martinsville at all, very much. I went to St. Paul's College.
Oh, I didn't know. I forgot.
It's in Lawrenceville, Virginia. It's very tiny. I think at the time when I went there, there were a total of 500 students there. Maybe 250 women and maybe 250 guys, or give or take 50 more on one end. But I know there was 500. What can I say about St. Paul's? I felt the same way there that I did in Martinsville. Everything was close-knit. Everyone knew everyone. You knew them by their name. The only dynamic was that you had different people from different places. And again, I continue to go back to Martinsville. I feel like when I think about Martinsville and I think about the people that are there and the people that I grew up with, they're good, solid people. They have good, solid foundations. Their parents had good, solid foundations, whether they worked in a factory or they worked as an engineer in the factory or they owned their own business. The morals and standards were basically the same. You go to school, you get an education. Luckily, when I went to St. Paul's, somehow, some way, again, the majority of the people that are there or that I went to school with, they came from like mostly kind of like the same kind of upbringing that I came from. And they had kind of like the same morals and standards. And I say that to say, the other day, I happened to be looking at my Facebook page, and I was just overwhelmed to look to see that the people that I went to high school with, the people that I went to college with, they all are very successful now. And, I know success can be measured in several different ways. When I say successful, what that means to me is what they're that to. They've gone there. They've completed it. I have friends that are principals of high schools. I have friends that are writing motivational books. Friends that are, I mean, just doing exactly what their goal was, you know, when they set out doing this thing. And not only have they made their personal goals, they have families, they have children, and I see them instilling the same principles that their parents instilled in them. And that really makes me feel good, you know, because not everyone is blessed to or has a chance or gets to go around, you know, or get to have people in their life that are really on the right foot moving towards, you know, what they're doing. And I just, you know, I just think it's a blessing and makes me so proud.
What did you take up in college?
St. Paul's College didn't have very many majors to choose from, but I chose criminal justice. And I can honestly say, I knew when I graduated high school, I had offers to go to other schools for basketball scholarships. And I think I was the second to youngest. I think there was one other person younger than me in my graduating high school class. I actually could have been a year behind, but I knew that in my family, I knew that after you finish high school, you go to college. So I knew I wanted to go to college. I didn't really know where. I knew I took my SATs. I knew I had to go somewhere. I knew that people wanted me to go to different colleges based on the basketball scholarships that were given. At the time, I was in a relationship that that I thought, you know, that was important to me. So a lot of things that I chose to do as far as school and even what I chose as my major had a lot to do with my final choice. So when I got to school, I think I may have been 17 years old going to college, what I said was, what has the least amount of math? I didn't like math. And so I said, you know what, the first thing I'm gonna do is find out what doesn't have math. And I know they had like biology, I know they had like teaching courses, some type of science, and I can't remember the other things. And I said, you know what, I'm gonna go with criminal justice. You know, and I felt like I was like a physically fit person, so maybe I'll end up being a detective or I didn't really know, or some probation officer. But that actual day when I was 17 years old and when I chose, that was my reasoning in choosing my degree in.
So now that you graduated in criminal justice, where did you go? Did you stay in St. Paul's area? Did you go back home? Did you come to the city? Where did you go?
I stayed there maybe a year or two in that area afterwards, working. Because what actually ended up happening is I got my degree in criminal justice. I did some work as a counselor in a jail. It was actually a Lawrenceville Correctional Facility. It was a private jail. For me to be, I don't even know if I was 21 at the time, or was I 20 or 21. That was a lot for a 21-year-old being in a jail with all those men. You know, I'd never had a job before in my life, until I graduated college. And when I did do that, it was just a lot on me. As far as working in the jail, you know, people would ask me my name. I would forget to call myself by my last name, and everything in the jail is, you go by your last name. So it was a lot on me. I told him I don't think I was cut out for this jail thing. It was a little creepy. And so what I ended up doing and what it's led me to is I began to work in the human services field. I took a job at a therapeutic residential treatment facility for adolescent females. Mm. So at this treatment facility, there were children, I think as young as 10 years old up to 17. These children were taken from, let's see, as far as Pennsylvania to DC, all the way down to Virginia. They were taken out of their homes through the social services system for several different reasons, abuse, neglect, and they couldn't go back to their homes. So from that point forward, I began to work in the human services field, therapeutically working with children. And that's how all that started.
Are you doing that now? Do you have your own business? Where do you go from here?
Okay, so after I did that for a while, I did go try probation, for a little while. And what I found out with probation was that a lot of my clients were coming in, some of them had substance abuse problems. So, you know, they were referred to me for probation. And the only thing I could do for them was to meet with them, report back to the courts, report back to the judge what they were doing, whether it was good or bad. And, you know, if it was bad, they go to jail. I really didn't have that much impact in really helping them. And what I felt like is a lot of the clients that came in, they truly had a problem. So that's when my whole heart went out back to the therapeutic side and said, you know what, I want to be on the other side. You know, I want to be on the other side where when someone truly has a problem, I want to be able to help them, not just to send this paperwork over to the courts to say, look, they have to be revoked, send them to jail. So that's when I got back into the therapeutic environment. And that brings me to where I am today. I don't directly, I deal with clients, but now I oversee programs. So I oversee programs that help women that have issues with substance abuse, domestic violence, homelessness. I'm trying to think of it. Any type of trauma that that women deal with, you name it, I deal with it. So I've gotten away from directly having to deal with them one-on-one, but I still manage counselors and caseworkers that do meet with clients on a regular. So I do kind of put out the fires between the client and the caseworker. I make the final decisions on a lot of things. So I still get to kind of get in there and make a difference. It's just kind of like on a different level. But yeah, definitely dealing with women that have gone through all types of trauma. Just recently, I've had my first encounter with a woman that was brought to the United States as she's a human trafficker. She was trafficked here for work. She came here to work, and people have been keeping her in the house to work. So, I hear everything from the abuse to the homelessness to the abuse to everything. And so, yeah, that's where I am now, which is from how I was raised and where I'm from, very different. Not saying that it doesn't go on where I'm from, but because we are like a village in my hometown, if people are homeless, other people look out for them. If people have domestic problems going on at home, they keep it quiet. If there is substance abuse going on in my hometown, I feel like we have enablers that kind of keep the families together. There's a grandmother, there's someone. So it's very interesting to see, and every day that I deal with it, it keeps me very, very humble. And it gives me humility every day to say that, you know what, only, you know, by the grace of God, that could be me or anyone else. And so
that's the one thing I could say at home, for whatever reason, financial, social, whatever, not everybody necessarily lived with mom and dad. Everybody lived with the cousins or the brothers, whatever the situation may be. But it was always somebody around to take care of you. Like if you couldn't, let's say there were some problems and you and your father could not stay together, you didn't go to a social service program, you just stayed with somebody else, and everybody else, and that person helped raise you. Do you see the lessons and interpersonal skills that we've gotten at home? Do you find those things imploring you more? I think sometimes granted, we need the structure and the lessons we got from college and a degree, but I felt like our humbleness and our beginnings provided more ammo to be able to do your job. Would you say that? Would you say your background from home helped you
Definitely.
more?
I hope.
Excuse me.
Yeah, I would definitely say my background from home has made my job easier. Yes, I'm saying that my background
Okay.
from home, exactly what you said, how people just, they see a need and they everyone chips in. That makes my job that much easier, because it's kind of like that's where I came from. That's what people do. People help people out. If there's, like it goes back to high school. If there's a kid on the team that couldn't afford to get their sneakers, the parents or somebody would chip in, and it didn't go on for days and days and days. People did what they had to do to kind of help out, and that comes naturally for me, to just kind of think of other people and what they may need at the time. And it definitely makes me think that, like, what I'm doing right now in my life, it makes it that much easier. It doesn't really so much feel like a job. It comes like second nature. And, I think the biggest thing is, and the biggest blessing in it all, is that a lot of a lot of the clients and consumers that I deal with, they have been in the system, in their life, most of them a significant amount of time. And, the difference that I try to make, is not really trying to fix their life, but trying to, but consistently being an honest person, consistently being straight up with them, consistently doing what I say I'm gonna do, and doing it. Again, that goes back to I feel like in my hometown, when people say they're gonna do something, they usually do it. It's not a whole, because where we're from, where are you gonna hide at? You're gonna see them somewhere else. So I feel like what you said, yes, being brought up the way I was brought up, being from my hometown, it's a lot easier, and it helps out a lot. Just being consistent, being honest, and having integrity, and having character, and doing what you say you're gonna do, and being consistent.
What other things that have you gotten involved in, hobby-wise, besides, working with social services, human services? That's a lot to do, and sometimes you need a relief or something else that you do. What are some other things have you gotten into?
I've gotten into several things. Yeah, definitely. My job is draining mentally, because you're thinking for a lot of people, and the stories keep coming, and the stories keep coming, and they're pretty rough, So yeah, as an outlet, what I do is I work out. I've always worked out, maybe not to the intensity level where I had a schedule where I go work out, this is what I do. I've always been physically active through the sports. So I'm always doing something, from zip lining to canoeing to just riding bikes. Let's see, this past, maybe last January, I had a girlfriend that she lost like maybe 60 pounds, and she invited me to go to a boot camp. I like going to the boot camps because it reminds me of like basketball practice. They kind of switch it up, and they have you doing agility drills, and I kind of like it, and it's kind of competitive a little bit. So I would go to the boot camps, and it wasn't really a challenge for me, but it was fun, and I liked it. So there was one day the boot camp was over, and the trainer of the boot camp just came to me and said, "Have you ever competed?" And I'm like, "Competed in what?" And he's like, "Competed in, done a show." I'm like, "What kind of show are you talking about?" He's like, "Bodybuilding." And I'm like, "No, I never did that, but my mom did, when I was like in first grade, but I don't know anything about it." And he goes, "Well, I think you'd be good at it." I said to him, "Really, you think so?" He said, "Yeah, I think you'd be good at it." Now, my first thing was, what do I have to do, and how long do I have to do it? Because that was my whole thing. And what he said to me was that, well, it's January. No, it's Jan March, April. It was January. It's January now. No, I'm sorry. It was December. It was like the end of December. It's December now. You would probably, that show will be in April. You would need to start working out like in the middle of January to be ready for April, and I think you'll be straight. I was like, well, you know what? Let me go home and think about it. You know, whatever. Give me a week, and I'll let you know by after New Year's or whatever. And and I also asked him what I have to do, and he's like, you would have to work out at least 4 days a week, like, you know, like meet with me and work out. And I'm like, okay, I'll let you know. So I had a good time over the holiday weekend or the week or whatever, and I called him back and I said, I'm going to try it. I'm going to do it. The challenge for me was that I have never had to be disciplined about working out. I've always maintained a healthy weight. I've always had a look of athleticism, and I've always been athletic. But to actually go to a gym and actually lift weights for a certain amount of time, to do a certain amount of reps, that was going to be a challenge for me. I'm pretty hyper. I like to jump around. I like to go from thing to thing to thing and just have fun. And all my life, sports have always come naturally to me. I mean, even when I was in gymnastics, like, it came naturally to me. Basketball came naturally to me. I mean, sometimes they would put us in the gym to lift weights. And I did it, but I just happened to be good at it. So this time I'm like, this is really a challenge. You're really going to have to stand here and do four sets of 15 of these, and we're going to have to see how it works. So my girlfriend committed to working out with me the 4 days of the week, plus I would incorporate boot camp, and that's how I got started. And that's when it took off. This sport was totally new to me, and I've done one other interview with my hometown newspaper about this, and I didn't really go into detail about that journey, but that journey in itself has been a journey. I know a lot of times I post a lot on Facebook, I post a lot on Instagram, and I make it look like it is easy. And for anyone that is thinking about going into the sport, it is definitely a lot more to it than having a nice body and lifting weights, you know, and that's what I've learned, you know, going through this. I don't know if you want to know about that.
Yeah,
or not, but
help yourself.
Okay. So after I began to work out, you know, for those couple of months, I then started to Google a little more information on it. Like I said, I've never, done bodybuilding. I've only done team sports, and the team sports that I've participated in, you show up for practice, your coach tells you what you need to do on game day, they bring your uniforms, you put them on, and you play. Bodybuilding isn't so much like that. It's a lot more to it than that. As I was starting to Google more information about it, I learned that there was a part where you were going to have to pose, you know, pose for the judges, just not look good, just not stand up there, but there were like a set of poses that they wanted to see. I talked to my coach and I'm like, hey, you know, you're going to help me with these poses? And, you know, he kind of brushed it off and he didn't really speak about it. I then started to see people posting things that they were doing when they were getting closer to their competition day. I reached out to a friend of my niece's who had competed before, and showed her a bikini that I was going to purchase. She let me know immediately, that bikini you're about to purchase, do not do it, because you're competing in bikini, that's a figure bikini. And I'm like, oh my goodness. And I was about to pay $600 for this bikini that I had shown my coach, that he said was perfect. That's when the red flags went up. Like, okay, my coach may not know much about this sport that I thought that he may have known. So, my niece's friend, Crystal, started telling me a little bit more of what she knew. She only did one competition, and she referred me to a lady that lived in Pennsylvania. I drove to Pennsylvania on two occasions to go meet with her to pose, because now it's getting down to crunch time. I think I'm like only 6 weeks away from this competition. Now, my body looks nice because I'm working it out, but I don't have the particulars down. I don't know what I'm supposed to wear exactly. I didn't know there was a difference in outfits, and I didn't know these certain poses that I'm supposed to do. And then I find out later you have to have music. and I didn't know what the music was supposed to be like. So my coach then sent me to someone to pose locally. When I went to go pose with the person, what the posing coach told me was that they were an actual bodybuilder. They actually trained my trainer that was training with me then for the one competition that he did. I immediately said, can you please, would you be willing to take me on for these last 3 weeks? Because I need the help. I don't think that my other trainer knows as much as you know about the sport, and I don't want to look silly on the stage. He accepted, and I had my second coach. I had my second coach 3 weeks out before my competition. Mm. Once I got with my second coach, he looked at me, and he's like, I don't know if you're going to be ready for this show, truth be told. And I'm like, wow. So where I thought I was going to be, I thought that I was in good shape, according to what the other coach said. He let me know that it's a possibility that you may not, you know, meet your deadline before the show comes. I was like, wow. So what I did was I went to the gym 2 times a day with this coach. And I mean, and I was just really busting my butt out of fear. Because, you know, I'd already paid my fees to be in the show. I had paid for tanning. I had paid for makeup, which I was already $1,000 in money-wise. I was upset. I was very furious with the first person that asked me to do this because my anger was basically, you don't play with people's money. Mm-hmm. You know, $1,000 is a lot of money to put into something when you don't 100% know what you're doing. And I blame no one for their intention, you know, if the intention is good. But when I think that you are involving money, I think that you should put a little more effort, you know, when someone else is willing to put in, give 100%, I need the other person to give 100%. So I began to train with my coach, my new coach, 2 times a day, busting my butt out of fear, not knowing what's going to happen. And then it's time for show day. I go to this event, I do my first bodybuilding competition, and I come out with 2nd place and 3rd place. To be honest with you, I was shocked, couldn't believe it, didn't know what to expect, didn't think I really even maybe deserved, maybe because of the fact of I rushed it all the way at the end and I didn't really know. So when I won, I was excited. But I was also confused, like, why? But what I did know was that at the end of the day, I know that I put in hard work. And that's all that matters at the end. And I said to myself, wow, you know, okay, if I get 2nd and 3rd, just jumping out here with everything that I've been through, imagine what I can do if I've learned more about the sport, if I give myself time to prepare for the sport and go from there. So once I got 2nd and 3rd place, I said to my coach, like, what's the purpose of all this? Like, I'm kind of cool with this, you know? He was like, well, no, you know, the thing is that you want to get your pro card. There's something called a pro card where you become a professional. Once you become a professional, everything you're doing, you get paid for it. And I said, oh, okay, you know, really, you know? So then I said, well, let me do this again. Let me try this again so I can get this thing that everybody seems to love, which is a pro card. I went back again, and again, I was not educated about the different federations. I wasn't educated about natural bodybuilding versus non-natural bodybuilding. So my coach tells me to do another show that he thinks that I would be wonderful at, that he thinks that I would get 1st place. That competition that I did, it was an NPC competition. NPC is a non-drug tested federation. I had no clue about this. I did the same thing. I worked out. I showed up that day. It was overwhelming. It was like so many people there. I think I competed against over 50 girls in my class. I have no idea what place I came in, but it wasn't 1st, 2nd, or 3rd. And it was a great experience because I've experienced what it's like to compete in a non-drug tested arena. But I've made the decision now that I know a little more about bodybuilding. I want to stay in natural bodybuilding. I want people to know that that the competitions that I do compete in, which are OCB, which stands for the Organization of Competitive Bodybuilders, they give you polygraph tests before the day of the show. And if you win, they give you a drug test immediately. I feel good about that, and I like that. So after I competed in that competition, that competition and the previous competition, there was a guy that came up to me and my parents, and you know, just told me that I had an awesome physique, and told me some things to work on after the first show. The second show, he found me again, and he said, you know what, I want to get with you and your trainer, and I want to talk to you guys, because there's no reason why that you should be coming in anything less than first place. I didn't reach out to him for a while, and I spoke to my trainer about it, and my trainer, you know, really didn't say much to me about it. He didn't give me much feedback. But what happened is the same person reached out to me again. They found me on Facebook and told me that they didn't want to cut into me and my current trainer, but they were willing to give advice and wanted to be a part of my team to make sure that I start to come in first place. So I shared it with my trainer. My trainer said, yeah, go check it out. I went to go meet with this guy, his name is Lauren. And he did an overall assessment on me, and he let me know what my weak areas were, and that I wasn't that great yet, and I hadn't really arrived. So, you know, he didn't care that I got second or third place before. You know, he was really honest with me about what I needed to work on and what's going to make me different from all the other girls. I accepted Lauren to train me and work out with me, and from that day forward, my training has changed dramatically. There was a time that I took pictures when I was working out. Lauren told me no cameras, no phones when we're working out. It's strictly going to be working out. He taught me some different techniques that I wasn't really doing correctly as far as lifting weights. Lauren is also a posing coach. What he taught me was how to pose to make my body look well, and that's one of the tricks to the trade is knowing that you can have imperfections with your body, but knowing how to display them properly is a part of bodybuilding, along with having a nice physique. So we continued to work out, and he said, you know what, I think you can be ready in 3 weeks. So again, I get this three-week crunch time to push it and try to get ready for this next show. And I met with him, and that was, we worked out once a day. I did posing for an hour once a day, and I ran 3 miles once a day every day. I changed my eating habits a little bit differently from what I did before. And August the 10th, I went to a competition, and I showed up, and I won the overall. I won first place for novice with those ladies, and I also won open overall. So I won my whole division. Wow. For bikini. And even to totally be honest with you, even when they told me that I won, I was excited that I won, but I didn't understand how big that was actually until I sat down with my coach, and he really said, like, not many people win over, you know, people win overall, but you beat everybody in your class, you know? And that's when it all really came to me to say, you know, like, all that hard work, all that getting up, all that discipline, the change in my eating habits altogether, going to bed to wake up early because to know that you have to go work out. You know, my basic day would go like this. I wake up in the morning around 4 or 5 to have my own private time to read, to kind of meditate, to kind of get myself together. At that particular time, I had to eat by 7 o'clock in the morning. And when I leave out of the door to do my 9 to 5, I have to dress for work in regular work attire. I have to pack a cooler of food for six meals that would be packed. I have to pack a bag for a change of clothes for my workout that evening. And then I have to pack a bikini to practice my posing in after the workout, and then another outfit to do my 3 mile run. And after that's over, I'm not done until like maybe 8 or 9 o'clock, to come back home to prepare my food for the next day, to wash my clothes again, to try to get into the bed by 10 o'clock to do it all again. So I definitely gave up a lot. I sacrificed a lot of my personal relationships with my friends. It took a toll on my relationships with my friends. And I didn't realize that bodybuilding was such a selfish sport until I was invited to go to a fitness seminar. And when I was there, a couple of people that have been doing this for years shared that everyone won't understand what you're doing. It's hard because you can't go out to eat. You know, your time is very limited, you know, and it's a very, very, very tough sport. But I can honestly say that I feel like if you can do this, and you can have the strength to do this and be disciplined with this, it lets me know that there's not too many other things that I don't think that I can't conquer if I can discipline myself to do this, because at times it does get hard. A lot of people eat out of emotion. Eating is comfort. Peanut butter and jelly sandwiches, things like that. It reminds you of home. It reminds you of warmth. And, you know, when you're doing this, it definitely is a go hard thing. Like you're going hard with everything. Like, you know, everything is discipline. Everything's discipline. And there are days that I do come home and it's hard and it's tough. And it's like, you want to give up. You're like, I'm tired of eating this food, you know, like, but you know, what keeps pushing me through, for me, I guess for me is that it goes back to what I said earlier. When you start something, you finish it. And that's what my mother said. So even through the midst of it, in the middle, when I said, oh my God, I'm not going to do this anymore. You finish what you start. You don't do it again if you don't want to, but you finish it. And that's a moral that my mom has always instilled in me, and I still have it now. And one of the other things that I do want to share is that I never realized through my posts, when I started working out and sharing it on Facebook and Instagram, it was all for fun. That's all it was for. And I never really realized how much of an impact that it impacted so many people by me doing that. And I really don't like to talk like that because I don't take credit for anybody else jumping into the fitness game or anything like that. But I have had negative responses, you know, sent to me in negative regard, you know, saying, oh, you post pictures all the time about you working out, you know, but and I still continue to do it because it was for me totally, but I've had at least over 40 women and men that said that, you know, just through my continuous dedication and consistency has motivated them to make some type of change in their life, whether it be what they eat, rather it be the doctor's been telling them they need to lose weight, whatever it's been. And knowing that, it made me like even say, you know what, if this can help somebody else and this is all I got to do is take a picture and be consistent, if I can bless someone that way, then I'm gonna do that, you know. So, and I think that a lot of blessings come that way, like when you're not looking for them or when you're not looking for anything. And I truly wasn't looking for anything when I started this whole thing, but I'm so glad that I was able to motivate some people. I know one of my cousins, she was having knee problems, and I can't remember exactly how much she weighed. I think she may have been like 170 pounds, and she's down to 140, and she looks wonderful. Mm. And I'm not saying that everyone has to be super healthy, and I'm not saying that everyone has to do, you know, what I do, but just to know that I've gotten thank yous from husbands, you know, that said, you know, you've motivated my wife. I've gotten thank yous from men, you know, that just said, you know what, you started a movement, you know what I mean, where people, you know, can see that it's fun. And it doesn't really, you don't have to do what I do. You don't have to go to bodybuild, but just making your having fun is what it's about, you know. So
how long have you been bodybuilding?
I started bodybuilding in January of last year. So this coming January would be a year that I've actually started. That's when I started, and I've done four shows. And I got my pro card in my second OCB show. Right. So that's another thing too. Things move really fast for me. So, you know, I got my pro card and didn't even know what OCB stood for at the time. You know, so like a lot of things with me, athletically, when I've gotten into things, just like when I was in eighth grade and I was playing JV basketball, when I was in ninth grade, I was playing freshman for the varsity team. I seem to move kind of fast, you know, with things. So I'm still now learning a lot about the Federation. I'm still learning a lot about, you know, natural bodybuilding versus non-natural bodybuilding, deciding on, you know, if I want to take this to another level, because right now I do bikini. One of my biggest complaints or one of my biggest requests was to my trainer, to all my trainers, was I don't want to look like a man. I don't look like a man. I don't want to look strong. And you know, they're like, no, you're fine. You're just going to do bikini. And so there is this one other thing that everyone, my coach has been asking me to do, is they want me to do figure. Figure is one step up from bikini. And what I did tell him was that if I place first place in a competition or second place in a pro show, I will attempt to compete as a figure competitor, and I can possibly get my pro card as a figure competitor. That would put me at having two professional cards in bodybuilding, one for bikini and one for figure, if I do figure. But like I said, this is definitely strenuous on you mentally. So, this is my first time having an off season. So I did my last show in October, and I am totally relaxing right now, just trying to maintain just a certain body weight. I don't have a vigorous schedule. I don't have like a routine that I do every day right now. Okay. Yes. Yeah, I don't have anything that like I continuously do right now, but starting in January, maybe the end of January or February, I will go back to prepping for a competition that I'm going to do in April. January the 11th, my coach is having a get together for his pro competitors that he has, and we're all going to sit down and go over what each and every one of our individual goals are for 2014. So he can map it out to help us figure out, you know, what we should do, what we shouldn't be doing. And I will definitely after January 11th.
Okay. How was it, and I'm asking this because it's kind of hard because I know you, but how is it now going from someone who's not exposing yourself physically, like we always, you know, we're dressed nice and things like that, but we don't show off a lot of stuff. Now you're in a position where you're wearing a bikini, and some of those competitions, depending on your size and build and things like that, you're almost next to nothing. Sometimes you're less clothed than you see in the music video, woman. So how does that, where you're all intents and purposes nude, it, versus being covered up, how is that for you?
That was an awesome question, because to be totally honest with you and anyone that's thinking about doing this sport, most competitions that I go to, yes, you are so close to being naked. It's you're almost naked. But what I can honestly say is I feel comfortable there, because it is, most people that are there are truly there about the sport. I would have a little concern if anybody could just come. No, let me say this. Anyone can't come to a competition. Yeah. Most competitions are gonna cost you $60 to come in. So most of the people that choose to be there are there to support, are they're truly in, they're in the sport, they're competitors. So you don't get the group of guys that just wanna come see some hot girls in bikinis. I don't know too many people, and in my experiences in the few shows that I've been in, there has been no one there like that. So it's all about business when you're there. It's kind of like a beauty pageant. Everyone, you know, it's like everyone's backstage, everyone's trying to get ready, everyone's trying to, you know, everyone has worked so hard to get to this point. You know, the last thing that usually comes up is that, oh, you're half naked, you know, like everyone's kind of walking around like ready to show off what they've worked so hard for. And usually the people that are out in the audience are usually family members. Like I said, usually it's about $30 to get in the first show, and then to come back for the second show, it's another $30. So it kind of eliminates just people that are trying to hang around just for the look of just women. Pretty much that's how it's been. It's usually family oriented, and supporters. So, you know, that's the good part about it. It's not $5 to get in, because if it was $5 to get in, it would be like a striptease show, kind of like for everybody. So that's what I do like about it, and it's strictly professional. It is treated as a sport. It is competitive, very much so competitive. I mean, some days when you're leaving, you have girls crying, you know, you've worked hard to get to where you think you should be. And you're judged. Your judge is hard. And of course, just being a woman itself, you know, to be put on the stage with 10 or 12 or 13 other women, you know, you're getting compared, you know? So even as a woman, you know, you have to have a sense of self-confidence in yourself to understand that this is a sport. You never know who's going to show up that day. And just because you don't win that day doesn't mean that you didn't bust your butt and you didn't do whatever. It just means that you got to go back to the drawing board and you got to get better. So for anyone that's never, ever been to a bodybuilding competition, and to be totally honest with you, I've never been to one either, other than the ones that I've competed in. But the ones that I competed in, it's serious, you know, and I've been to ones where it's kind of cutthroat. You know, people are serious. Some people don't talk. Some people do talk a lot, you know, but it's just as competitive as any other sport out there.
I've been to a few, nothing okay. recently, but the last few years. But when I went to the intensity level, I went with a friend whose sister was bodybuilding. And we were in New York, and the intensity is just to me, and I know this may tick a few people off, it was higher than you would see in some football fields. Like, people did not speak, people did not talk to each other, some were still eating vegetable trays, whatever, in the back room, and then afterwards they're just so pumped and full of energy. And it's still an hour afterwards, and then some people are just coming from really highs and lows of lows, where some wanted to jump off that bridge that next day, you know, because they didn't win, like right. You said. It is really a gut-wrenching, emotionally intensive sport.
Yes, it is. And
no, go ahead, sorry.
No, what you were just saying was on top of whatever they're doing for their final five before the competition, you know, carb depletion. So everybody's like irritable. You know, some people are irritable, some people are nervous, you know. So yeah, you're right. What I've learned is that a lot of women compete and they don't always have the support at home, you know, mm-hmm. from their loved ones or their husbands. So, you know, emotionally on top of that, I didn't realize that a lot of women went through that. So it definitely is an emotional journey, you know, with it being mostly in the past a male dominated sport. Sometimes women that are married that choose the sport don't always get the support from their significant other that they would like. I've talked to women that were competing whose husbands were in the hotel but wouldn't come to the show. So, you know, it's interesting, and you're right. It's a lot.
How does it feel Now you having to get a tan or spray tan and makeup. You know, you're already a naturally beautiful woman, but now you gotta, someone's telling you, you gotta get a tan and makeup along with this to look beautiful in your bikini. How is that as a woman being told, okay, you're fine here, but you ain't beautiful here. You need to do this. And for someone who's always been told you're a beautiful woman, how is that a change for you?
Well, it will change for me. Actually, when I heard that, I was like, wow, that's the fun part. You know, you're going to get primped and prepped, you know, all around. So, you know, I heard all this stuff about working out. I heard all this, you know, about doing the work. But then when I saw the bikinis, I'm like, oh, they're hot. Like, they're super pretty. And then they were like, oh, you get makeup done? And I was like, whoa. But the very first time that I competed, to me, it was a big oxymoron. I'm going out here to look strong, but you're putting this makeup on me and you're giving me this tan. Like, I was just looking like, I felt it was a culture shock for me. Like I said, because I didn't know anybody that competed. When I was at the hotel, I kept seeing these people walking around with these tans on, and I didn't have my tan yet. And I'm like, they look like freaks of nature. You know, I'm like, what is going on? And I had actually had tan. I had been tan before. So I was familiar with being tanned. I didn't know, you know, how this would look being in a bikini, trying to show my muscles. So I was really confused about it at first. But like I said, my current coach right now has been bodybuilding for 16 years or so. He's been in the business for 16 years. And one thing about him is he's very educated about everything. And now everything that I have questions about, or even when he just tells me things, it makes sense. I understand now 100% why I want that tan. I understand why we need it. The tan shows your muscles and it brings out a lot of things in your body that maybe you wouldn't naturally see. And, you know, when I get to that competitive level, you know, when it's time to compete, I'm like, bring that tan on. You know, so now it's like a thing that I look forward to. Like, yeah, I'm ready for that tan. Give it to me. Because, look, I worked hard. I see these little muscles here. Double me up on the tan, you know. And then when it comes to makeup, it's like, yeah, give me that makeup, because guess what? I got to look good on the stage. So, you know, you know, just like Beyonce when she gets on the stage, make me flawless, you know, because what I've learned is that's part of it too. Your presentation and being on stage has a lot to do with it. And I learned that, like, your tan, they take off points for your tan. If it's not even, they take off, you know, they don't take off points for how you look. Looking well doesn't hurt at all. So that part of it I do like. The part that is kind of crazy to me is that I'll share this with people that they may not know. I take my shower the night before, and Saturday may be the show. Saturday morning, I get tanned. There's no more showering, you know? So you're walking around that whole day, like, looking beautiful, maybe not smelling so hot, you know, looking hot, but maybe not the cleanest in the world, because the last shower you may have had may have been like that night before, or first thing in the morning, like, the night before, maybe they tanned you, and then you get tanned again that morning. But we're a bunch of pretty girls walking around with no deodorant on, you know, because we can't use deodorant because it turns colors against the tan. So we are some funky women. Looking at those pictures, look hot, but we're not, you know, we're not the freshest in that area.
How is the, you mentioned that there's a lot of you contact and y'all share communication stories and a lot of things with the other bodybuilding women. How is it now that we often hear and unfortunately display different cultures, bad women not getting along in different cultures and TV, between the TV shows and things like that? How is the animosity level behind the stage working out when you go to the gym and you see somebody else working with each other? I'm led to believe from what I'm seeing and from you and others, it's a close-knit network just because of the fact that you need each other's support, but the aspect of we have to work together and we have to get along. And sure, you may not agree, but we have to go through these different things. How is that level right now?
That level with me, part of my personality, is I kind of stay to myself, mostly. And I can, as far as bodybuilding and working out, In the beginning, like I shared with you, the first coach that came to me, he did boot camps. So none of the women in the boot camps were competitors. So it would only be me, him, and my one friend that joined. When I got my second coach, I only met with him, and he had no other competitors that competed in bikini bodybuilding. He had one other competitor that did figure. So there was never any animosity, and we both paid him, so we had different time slots. So we never ran across it. And the few shows that I've done, the first one, I didn't know what I was doing. I was new to it. You know, I didn't really talk to anybody because I didn't even know anybody, and I didn't talk to anyone. My second show was so huge, and it was in a different federation. It happened so fast, and it wasn't like the other one. So it was new to me. So again, you know, I just kind of went on stage and kind of left. And the third, the show that I won at, again, I just kind of hopped on stage. Like, I kind of do my own thing and I leave. And every show that I did was like rush back to back to back. I will be able to have more feedback from you, like, as far as like dealing with, other competitors now, because finally this is my first time that I've actually had a chance to just breathe. Like, I'm not in a race to, like, because I have a competition next month. So this is my first off season. This is my first time, like, not having a workout regimen. This is my first time that I'm gonna meet my coaches, other competitors, that are also pro athletes. I'll meet them on January the 11th, and I think he has another bikini girl that does bikini, and she's a pro. So, you know, that will be my first time to actually get to meet and hang out with and see how other competitors, women, are going to treat me, or if it's going to be the caddy situation, if it's going to be like, you know, what is it called? Like the reality shows, like on TV. But as of right now, the last show that I did with my coach, and he had another client there. She is a bodybuilder, but she is like the real bodybuilder, more built, more, you know, and she won the overall. I actually like her. We get along very well together, but again, we don't compete in the same division, you know? And so it's going to be fun to see, you know, what it's going to be like to actually meet some other girls that, compete in my division. So like I said, the first time that I competed, I got second and third, you know, I was just like, wow. You know, I was just ready to go eat afterwards. You know, I left, you know, that was cool. The second one I told you was really fast. The third one, I won. As soon as I won, they yanked me to the side to go do a drug test. I didn't even get to see the girls I compete against. But I do keep in contact with three of the girls that when I won the overall, I keep in contact with them via like social media, Instagram and Facebook. And they're actually sweet girls, you know, but we don't talk on the phone because they don't live in my area. But I think one of them is a college student at UVA. The other one has chose to go to the other federation. So I don't plan to compete in her federation. She doesn't plan to compete in mine. But I see their posts. They comment on my posts. And they're pretty supportive, you know, and we're supportive to each other. But yes, I will, now that I'm in the pro circuit, I will most likely be competing against the same pros now. So now I'll know the faces, like, oh, that's so-and-so. She has great legs, you know, when I go against her. That's who, you know. So this is probably, now that it's my pro time, now I'm really going to see who's out there, who's going to show up, you know, and they're going to be the same people that I'm running into. And this is when you really see how it's really going to go down, because this is supposedly the best of the best. So we'll see how the cattiness goes and who's going to be hiding people's shoes at the show and tripping you up on the way. No, I'm just joking. But yeah, you actually, you know, if it's going to be like Mean Girls or like a pageant kind of like.
How does it run heels on the stage?
Actually, you know, I am a true 100% girly girl, and it's kind of crazy because, you know, I tell people that, you know, it was a time when my mom couldn't get me in a dress, and like I wore my hair short all through high school. You know, I didn't grow my hair out until college. So, like, when I show people pictures of me or I tell people I play basketball, I play sports, they're like, they don't believe it, you know, in my adult life. They're like, what, you know, so, but it's just so weird that, you know, growing up, I was a tomboy, couldn't care less about a dress or heels, but I am a heel wearing lady right now. And I like heels and I love to wear them, and wearing them on stage to me, for me, I don't know about any other female, that's to me, like, that's my kick. Like, that to me gives you your sexiness, you know, and it, I don't know if everyone knows, but heels does a lot for your body. You know, it lifts you up a couple inches. It makes you look longer. I'm short, I'm only 5'5". So I love my heels. I want to talk to my coach on January the 11th to see if I can go up a couple of inches, if it's legal, you know, in the competition. But I absolutely, I love it. I just recently did a hair show, fashion show, for the Glenn Jackson, here. I did it for him in DC, and, you know, it was real catwalk stuff, you know? So, you know, I'm thinking, yeah, you know, I like this. And there's a girl that's been doing it for years. And when she came off stage, she's like, oh my God, I fell. And I was like, wait a minute. Never thought about that happening. So, you know, as of right now, I'm loving that walk. I'm loving the heels. But we shall see. If I ever hit the floor, you may not hear the same thing from me later on. Saying,
how?
But yeah, she told me she.
No, I'm sorry. Go ahead. She told you.
Yeah, she just told me that, you know, and I like her. Like, she's a great walker. Like, whenever we were at practice, I'm like, wow, she has this thing down pat. Like, she's like a little Naomi Campbell. And then, you know, as the show was going on, I'm in the back, we're changing clothes. She's like, oh my God, I fell. I said, you fell? And I'm thinking, if she fell, you know what? There's a possibility I could fall. I could fall. You know. So yeah, as of right now, the heels, I love it. You know, let's just pray I don't fall. But you know, Beyonce's fallen, so we'll see. It's just how graceful you get up afterwards, right?
I think
how graceful you fall.
I think it's a rite of passage that you fall a couple of times. As long as you get up, this is matters. What?
I hope that surpasses me, and I don't have to.
What are some of the this gonna be a fun one? What are some of the imperfections that you're working on right now in your bodybuilding in terms of lines? Is it deltoids, certain areas of your back? What are some lines that you feel you're trying to improve on?
Oh, I can definitely tell you. My coach will tell me all the time. Well, I always get my Facebook love and my Instagram love about how great my body is. My weak points, as far as competing, so that you will know, I compete in bikini bodybuilding. And to give you an idea of what they're looking for, open up a Victoria's Secret magazine. That is the look that they're looking for. So if you happen to look at some of the runway models, or some of the Victoria's Secret ladies, that is actually the body that they're looking for. I do not fit the body type of a bikini model. So after I first competed and I received second and third place, my second coach told me, you need to go to figure because you have a figure body. I told him that I don't want to jump around and I don't want it to look like, oh, I didn't win, so I'm just going to go to another division. You know, I stayed the course and I told him I was going to do what I needed to do to be able to compete with those other girls. So for me, my biggest challenge is I am African American. I naturally have glutes, actually have a large butt, that's just natural, that where a lot of the females that do compete in bikini, that's one of the things that they work on. They want glutes, they push to have a butt. So with me, I already have the butt. I have to really make sure that I change my diet, and I really have to do a lot more cardio than most to get to the size where I'm not over proportioned. Per se. So that means for me, like right now, I'm weighing it at like 143 pounds. And a lot of that is muscle. Mm-hmm. But for me to compete on stage with the other females, I have to get down to 130, about 130, once we have, which is very, very, very small.
That's
very
that's
small.
That's the lower weight class.
Well, they do not weigh you in for bikini at all. It's just what they're looking for. And they're not looking for you to be 130 pounds. It's just most of the girls that I'm competing against, their body types are a little different. And I guess, I don't know how to explain it. Like I have naturally strong legs and they can appear to be big. So, they don't want a lot of muscle definition. They don't want a lot of, So I have to watch that. And I also have to watch, my body be in proportion. So I don't fit the description of a bikini person. So to answer your question, the areas that I have to work on are my hamstrings. Keep my hamstrings very tight, making sure that around my waistline is very toned. And when I'm posing, making sure that because they only judge bikini people, they judge them from the front and they judge you from the back. So when I turn to the back, my butt is larger than everybody else's and there's folds in different places underneath my butt that you can be taking points off for. So I have to make sure that I don't show those folds. And that's pretty much in the competitive world. Me personally, before I started competing, I didn't like my legs, meaning that I didn't think that I had the best legs ever. You know, when I just used to work out on my own. Now, what I do know that that is my own personal self critiquing myself. I don't think the world had a problem with my legs at all. But, I think it's important to let women know, I think it's important to let women know that, we're only as good as we think that we are. You know what I mean? I shouldn't say that. We're not only as good as we think we are. What it is that everybody has imperfections about yourself, you know? And a lot of the time, the world doesn't even know them. And so my thing is, to me, my legs are my weakest points, but I still carry them and show them out in public. And you don't have to let people know that, you know? But that was my personal insecurity, was my legs. I thought that they could be defined a lot more, and I thought they were kind of thick, and that was just my thing. Something that people probably don't know is that when I started working out and I started to do bodybuilding, I made sure that I wore shorts every day. I wouldn't have in the past wore shorts. I would have always wore like the longer pants. I purposely did it because I didn't like it. And I felt like if I look at it every day, it's gonna keep making me push to be better. So, I have gotten comments, on my Facebook page about what I wear when I work out. No one knew this, but that was strictly for me. Because what I believe is if you don't like something, if you mask it, you don't know how bad it is. If you show it, then you see it every day. If you don't like your stomach, show your stomach while you're working out. If you're able to do that, if you're not around a lot of people, because you know what? You can see your progress. You can see, it's there. So my legs were one of the things that I used to not like. I used to not wear shorts, other than back when I played basketball, but like in 2006, 2007, 2008, I owned two pairs of shorts, like two pairs of casual shorts. I wore jeans in the summertime. I wore skirts, that went longer, but I would never wear shorts. So to make a long story short, I wore the shorts in the gym. I am so ecstatic about my legs right now. I love my legs. And it just goes to show that everyone has things about themselves that they don't like. Some things we can fix, some things we can't. But I encourage anyone that doesn't like a portion of their body to own it and say it, own it and say that I don't like my legs or these are not the things, so no one can hold that over your head and no one can say, oh, you have messed up legs. Like, okay, yeah, I know what, I own it, and I can make them better or I can choose to keep them the way they are. So yeah, that is my weakest point. My coach tells me that, like from my thighs down, like my thigh area and around my butt area, I just got to keep that toned because that's where my weight goes, which being a black female, people on the street, they don't mind that. You know, it's like, okay, because being a black woman, most black women are curvaceous. You know, we have curves and they're embraced, and that's something about being a black woman. So when I compete, yes, I still have curves compared to the other women, you know. However, I do have to deal with the other side of it. One of the things that you brought up at one point in time, I think you brought up like racism.
Right.
Back in my hometown. This really isn't racism, but I can honestly say that when I was telling you that bodybuilding was strenuous on me, it's very hard because mentally, because while people are rooting you on, like, honestly, I feel like I get a lot of support from my Facebook people saying, keep going, you're motivating me. But it's weird because a lot of my personal relationships with my friends, they don't understand. And I get comments from them that they don't actually mean. I don't think they mean anything by it, but they make the comments, oh, you're getting so small. When is this going to be over? I hope this is your last show. You know, because they're around me all the time, and they see, you know, when I'm eating differently, my body does start to change. And maybe the curvaceous Tiffany that I was like 4 months ago, the curves aren't really there anymore. You know, it's more like, you know, Tiffany's about to go to the Olympics, Tiffany, you know? And so I understand that they don't totally understand the sport.
I think a lot of that,
you know, it's hard when you're trying to push through something, and it's like,
I'm sorry, it's a second delay. I apologize.
You can go ahead.
I know. I'll say a lot of that comes from the few bad sides of growing up where we are. We're not open to a lot of different things that's like out there. Like, we've had the opportunity to travel and see in the world and do a lot of other different things versus a lot of people that, you know, you raise us up to get experience and do different things. But when we do them, it's hard for someone to understand it because they're not around it, or it's not a common thing in the area. Like, other than you, a couple other people, is there anybody else doing bodybuilding? No. But there's a bunch of people who are police officers, counselors, teachers, you know, so it's not something that is readily available they can relate to.
Yes, I totally agree. So it's kind of like, you know, I have, you know, some of my close friends are like, you know, they're like, yay, you won, you know, or like it's getting close to the end. They're like, oh, I cannot wait till you can eat regular food again. Oh, I cannot wait to, you know, like, is it over yet? Or, you know, I get comments like, oh, you know, your butt's getting kind of small. And I'm like, yeah, I know. But, you know, it's just like any other sport. And I have to remind them, you know, it's just like a boxer. It's just like a wrestler. You know, it's only for that competition day and that's it, you know. And what I've had to do, and I've had to sit down and I've had to say, you know, as you know, if you can respect it the same way you kind of respect Mayweather and all the other people that do what they have to do at crunch time before they get ready to compete, just look at it this way. I say, if I'm disciplined enough to be able to do this, imagine how disciplined I can be in other areas of my life, you know, as a wife, as a mother, you know, as a teacher, as whatever else. And that's what I look at it as, you know, putting in the dedication and putting in the work, and just understanding that what I'm doing is only for a sport. I don't live like that all the time. It would not be healthy, you know what I mean, to only eat 1,200 calories a day, you know what I mean? Like, so you have to also be very balanced and know exactly what you're looking for in doing this. I can honestly say after my first show, 3 days after, you know, after the show, I looked at myself and almost went into a slight depression saying, oh my God, what happened to my body? Like, you know, but what I realized was like, that was only for show day. It's only for show day, and once the show day is over, that's okay. You can maintain a healthy lifestyle, but you're not gonna walk around looking like you're ripped up, like six pack popping out every single day, you know, unless you're gonna be on some type of drug, you know? So that took me a little while to accept, and that was a psychological thing that I had to go through. And I haven't had the time. I don't really have a lot of time. I post a lot of pictures, and I said in 2014, I am gonna try to do better on Facebook and Instagram, on talking more about what I'm doing, because I do feel like, as well as I've motivated people to work out, I don't want to mislead any young people. I don't want to mislead any people my age. thinking that like I walk around looking like that every day, because I don't, you know. And sometimes or people email me or people contact me and they want to know what diet that I'm on or what I'm eating, and I've given it to them and I've told them what I eat, but realistically, you know, I do that for training. So, you know, I have a responsibility, you know, in that, and I feel like getting back out there and sharing with them that, like, no, I'm normal too, and I do normal things. You know, that was only for competition prep. So if you're running around trying to eat only 1,200 calories, you might pass out on us. You know what I mean? And trying to go to the gym twice a day, because everybody's body is different. And so, you know, I'm making a promise to myself in 2014 to try to get better. You know, I don't know everything about the sport. Like I said, I jumped into this very fast. Whatever I do know, I do share. But I also feel like I have a responsibility to get with a couple people that I see that's on the road to, like, losing weight, and they're doing very, very good. But the main thing is coming up with a lifestyle that you can keep consistent, because I don't think anybody wants to eat fish and asparagus every day, you know what I mean, for the rest of their life. You know, that's not what life is about. You know, you do everything in moderation. So I have to work on that.
Are you doing, would you like to do this full time versus like part time, or like you're working out and setting yourself up full time for competition, obviously, but are you looking to do this full time and leave the social service aspect of the human services aspect alone for a while, or are you looking to continue to do both parts?
Honestly, okay, I am doing both parts right now. I'm a pretty spiritual person. I wouldn't say super religious, but I'm very spiritual. I feel like that it was a reason that I started to do this. I don't know where it's going to lead me to. I've been sitting back patiently, kind of just sitting back to see where it would lead me. I've been given offers. People have asked for me to train them. People have, you know, say that I'm a great motivator. I think I'm all those things. And I do think at some point in time, it's going to lead me away from what I do in the daytime to kind of do this. For some reason, like in the past month or so, I think there's going to be a way that I can incorporate this with maybe helping the underprivileged. I don't know how it's going to go, but I'm sitting back to kind of see where it's going to lead me. But what I do know is, throughout my day, when I interact with my clientele in their situations, a lot of them have health conditions. A lot of them have health conditions because, one, you know, they don't have access to healthy foods, or they don't know about it. You know, they know what's quick and they know what's fast. And the majority of the women that I work with right now, I think the youngest one of my, in my two programs, I think the youngest person I have, I think, is 34. So most of the women that I deal with are in their 40s and their 50s. And so a lot of them are diabetics. A lot of them are they have high blood pressure. And the thing is that they've gotten to a point in their life where they're tired of being tired. They're tired of being abused. They're tired of being on drugs, you know. And so now they're really taking the time to take care of themselves. And what they do is they go to the doctor and they take their meds, you know, and I feel like there's a part that can pour into them, the health side of it, you know. And it doesn't mean that they have to become bodybuilders. It just means that, you know what, you know, little they can do, stop eating the canned foods, you know, because the canned foods has sodium in it, you know, showing them that, you know, if you do have food stamps, a lot of people don't know, but you can go to the market, I don't know what they call it, but the farmer's market. I don't know if it's like that in Virginia, but, you know, in other states, you can use your food stamps at the farmer's market and you're allowed to get double. So, you know, if it's $2, you can get $4 of it. And so if they just know how to come back and prepare those foods, you know, steaming them and just learning other healthy alternatives, you know, it could take some of that stress away, because, you know, it's no sense in getting clean. Well, it's not no sense. I shouldn't say that. But they come to a life, they come to a point in their life where they've gotten everything else correct. You know, they've realized that, like, I don't want to use drugs anymore. I don't want to do whatever. okay, well, let's see about the other, because life is full circle, you know, spiritual side, health side, your mental health side, and everything else that goes along with your finances. And so I do feel like at some point in time, I think that's gonna merge together. And of course, like everything else, taking a step away from your 9 to 5, knowing what you're gonna get every month or every 2 weeks, you know, takes trust and faith in God, you know? So it's funny that you asked me that. I do think in very, very soon, I won't be doing that anymore, you know, like in that capacity. Pretty soon, like, I won't be doing that. But I want to make sure whatever I do, it's from the heart, it's genuine, and it's with the right intentions. Because what I realize is that the majority of the world, people are looking for something. People are wanting to be happy. People want to be a part of what looks happy and what looks good. And I want to do everything with the right intentions and with the right heart, because there's so many people out here that are, you know, I've had people come to me and say, oh, why don't you do a DVD, you know, a fitness DVD? Why don't you like sell menu plans on the internet, you know? And for me right now, whenever people email me, whenever people inbox me, you know what? I just pay it forward the same way somebody paid it forward to me. You know, to be honest, you know, some of my training that I have received, some of the things that I've gotten, some of my meal plans and things like that, someone didn't charge me for it. You know what I mean? And that was a blessing. Mm-hmm. So, you know, if I can bless somebody else, you know, I want to do that. I'm not saying I want to work for free. You know, that's not what I want to do. But, you know, until I, you know, get to a point and figure out what this is, you know, 100%, then yeah, I will be at my 9 to 5, but I am preparing to kind of get away from that. I've been doing that this whole weekend. I actually stayed in this whole weekend, changing up some things, because yeah, I might be saying goodbye to that 9 to 5, you know. Okay. Because I still want to be involved helping out with people, you know. And so if I can figure out a way to maybe not have such an important role at my job and still be able to volunteer or maybe do something at a smaller level, I would like to do that.
So if I become president, I can just hire you to be, you know, Secretary of Physical Fitness or something like that.
Yes. I have a few friends, and I guess it would help. I have a few friends that do some things with fitness, and I definitely told them that I would be willing to help them out. So yeah, that's definitely me. However I can help out, I have no problem doing that.
What other doors, and you sort of answered this a little bit, but what other doors, avenues has the fitness opened up? Has it opened up? Have you done modeling? Have you gotten into magazines? Any being able to be a public speaker, going around speaking on the different journeys and paths of this life in this world, and how does this benefit you in so many different ways? You be able to present that as a profession.
Yes, there have been several doors that have been offered to me. Again, I don't move fast. Like I say, it's a cruel world out here. And I must say, I am a female. I do move with precaution with everything. So with that being said, the bodybuilding thing is just straight. I go there, I compete, and I know what that is. The other stuff that comes along with it, I have had offers for photo shoots for magazines and things like that. I move slowly with things like that because sometimes not all the time the person has good intentions. So what I do is I try to build relationships with people, get to know them first, understand what their platform is and what they're really looking for before I move forward. I have a friend that has a modeling agency out of Florida, and he asked me to join the modeling agency on the fitness side of it. So that's in the making right now. Right now they're doing a couple of things. I don't know where that's going to lead me, but I'm definitely open to that. I have done, or I am supposed to be doing a interview with a magazine pretty soon with that. But like I said, I stay humble. I stay kind of cautious with everything. And I don't just jump when someone makes an offer to do photos, to do things like that. Because, you know, like I said, I do come from a small town. And I do want to keep everything in perspective. And I do want to think, I would like to keep things respectful, you know. And right now, I don't have an agent or I don't have anybody representing me. And like I said, it's a cutthroat world out here. And I just want to be clear about what it is, you know, that I'm doing before I do it. So, yeah, I have had offers, but I do take them quite slow. And I am very suspicious. I was offered to do a photo shoot for I don't really know the name of the company right off or the magazine, but it's a magazine out of Atlanta. And I told them what I'll do is when I come to visit, I would like to sit down and talk to them and see more about, you know, what it's about rather than hopping on a plane and going to do a photo shoot. And I get there and it's a different type of photo shoot I'm thinking about, you know? So mm-hmm. Yeah, I take things slowly, you know, and I feel like I've been blessed that way, handling things that way. And that's pretty much it.
You ever thought about doing the CrossFit or the Ironman games and things like that?
I wasn't really familiar with CrossFit. You know, I had seen the gyms, you know, I've seen them in passing and I'm looking in there like, wow. And I have a couple of friends that are athletes, professional athletes. And sometimes in the off season, I see them rolling tires around and things like that. Because I've been back to back, working on my competitions, I haven't been able to, you know, check into it because I have my regular routine. But between now and January, I'm definitely going to jump in CrossFit and give it a chance one time to see what it's like.
I think you would do very well with CrossFit. You know, the only thing I get worried about is for you, I guess, is the and I forgot the name, but it's the different reps with the different barbells with the weights to it, and then the swinging with the ropes. Then granted, you have a background with it with the gymnastics, but the weight going down and then come back up swinging, bunch of pull-ups, come back and down, back and forth, the heavy lifting part of it, that's the increase. I say, oh my gosh. But I think you would do very well with it, if not win.
Yes, so I'm gonna try it. I have no idea. My niece Brittany, she did practice CrossFit for a couple of months or whatever. But yeah, like I always like a challenge and I'm willing to try it. I'll be the first one to tell everybody if I hate it, you know, but I want to try it. I have a friend that has a CrossFit gym, and actually I was going to speak with him today when he gets off work to see, you know, what day this week maybe we could go in the gym to see what this CrossFit is about. Because it might be something that I would be interested in. And I have never, ever, ever read about the Ironman game, so I don't know anything about it, but I plan on checking that out.
What is the next stage in Miss Tiffany Lynch's life? Granted, you said you look into other things to transition from human services, but still have a hand in it because you want to give back and help. But you're transitioning to other ventures, still continuing on. What is the overall goal, you would say, Tiffany Lynch, 5 years from now or 10 years from now?
Well, I'm 34 years old. Mm-hmm. I started this whole bodybuilding thing kind of late, you know, in all actuality. So for me, right now at this moment, it may not be something that I want to continue to do and continue to do for the next 3-4 years. What I told my coach was that I wanted to compete as a pro. I want to get first or second place, and then that was going to be it for me. Until he told me that I should try and figure. So, you know, if I can kind of squeeze that in and get that done, I would be so happy. But, you know, I think that I've had enough Tiffany time, meaning, you know, I've done all this selfish sport of bodybuilding. I've given a lot of time and energy to that. I've given a lot of time and energy to my career, you know, going to school. And I think personally, for myself, to be totally honest, I think it's time for me to put after the competitions stuff. It's time for me to put a little more energy into my own personal life, which means towards my future of having a family and having a significant other to relate with. And, you know, because I definitely think that's important. And I think a lot of times I display a lot of Tiffany. And, but I do come from a family. My parents have been married over 40 plus years. And I definitely want to have the same thing. I am ready, not exactly today, but, you know, after I do after I get my other competitions out of the way, I'm ready to have a Tiffany, a little Tiffany or a little junior running around. I'm ready to be in that arena with my husband. And I want to see what my kids are going to be able to do, you know, and I want to still be able to jump around with them and do things like that, you know. So, you know, I'm ready. I'm, you know, as much as I am the baby in my family and as much as the spotlight is on me a lot of the times, you know, I'm here with someone else. And, you know, I'm not getting any younger and I'm not rushing saying that I want to be married next year or anything like that. I'm just saying that I think, whatever you put your energy into, I mean, you have to put energy into everything. And I think that, like, my personal relationships with my friends and my loved one have been on the back burner because of not really my selfishness, but because of the sport that I've chosen to do. And so spending more time with my family, you know, my parents are getting older, spending more time with them and putting a little more energy into my dating life.
Well, I'm gonna say selfishly that anybody that's not gonna understand, but even if for the next 3-4 years or however long you decide to continue it, if they're not there to support you, be there, then it's not meant to be and everything. Because this is I'd rather see you once a year or barely at all if it means you completing your goals and what you want to do. So I'm grateful for that. That's just my
view.
I'd rather know you. You know, I don't get to speak to you as often, but I know you're out doing your thing and you're always there. So I'd rather you do that and be successful versus trying to balance the two and you don't know which way it's going. So how does Tiffany find time for Tiffany that's not doing your Tiffany, the fitness lady, your Tiffany, social services, human services for you, your Tiffany, the daughter, Tiffany, the sister, Tiffany, the best friend. What is Tiffany doing for Tiffany in terms of separate? Like, if you don't have any of these other different things or people bugging you for an interview, what is Tiffany doing for herself? What does she do to have fun?
One thing Tiffany does do, and I cannot deny this at all, is that I'm very clear on having a balanced life. And as hard as I do work, I play just as hard. So what Tiffany does for Tiffany is I love to travel. Up until this, from January until now, my traveling has been cut back tremendously. But when Tiffany breaks, and usually in the past, out of a month, at least 3 weekends, I'm definitely on a plane somewhere. You know, I have 4 girlfriends that live in 4 different states, and between going to LA to or Miami or Atlanta or Phoenix, I'm always somewhere. And luckily, most of them are entrepreneurs. They do not have families yet. So when we get together, we definitely have full time. If it just means, you know, me going to Atlanta for the weekend and we go to the spa. If it's, you know, every year make it my business to go to a Floyd Mayweather fight. If, you know, usually fights in May. I make sure that I go there. I enjoy that sport. I enjoy the city. We do girl stuff together. And when we do it, we definitely try to do it at the highest level. I definitely believe in treating myself. My family has always traveled. That's where I got it from. My parents usually travel at least twice a year. So I catch up with the family. You know, that's always it. Those weekends that I tell you that I go out of town, usually I try to make it home to be with my parents. And I've said this, I may have shared this on social media maybe once or twice, but what I do for Tiffany is when I go home to my parents' house, when I go to Martinsville, Martinsville is like a recharge for me. I don't know what anybody else from Martinsville, what they get from it when they go there, but it is just a recharge for me. When I go there, you know, I just love it. You know what I mean? I don't really make any plans to do anything, but just to go home, to go to my bedroom, to be at my parents' house, to just run downstairs and, you know, and just say hi to my parents. And, you know, me, I lived in the same neighborhood for 34 years, my parents' neighborhood. They lived there over 40 years. And, you know, my neighbors are still the same neighbors. So it feels good to know people that have known you since you were 3 years old, that, you know, they know everything. So that just feels so warming in itself. So when I go home, like, going to Martinsville is like going to like a spa, like in Phoenix for like 4 days, you know? So I just go home and it's relaxed. My parents check on me. Everything's just like a 10-minute ride away. Everybody, for the most part, is cordial to you. They speak. If you need any help at the bank or whatever, it can be 4:45 and they close at 5. They're not trying to lock the door, you know? They work till the time it's time to close, you know? So what Tiffany does for Tiffany outside of Tiffany, which may be displayed, I don't know how it's taken, like on Facebook, but I definitely invest back into Tiffany. And in investing into Tiffany means luxury, traveling, taking care of myself, going to the spa, being with my friends, having car service. I hate driving, you know? So, you know, I know a lot of people look at me and they're like, oh, why is she getting car service? Because that's a luxury that I give to myself. One thing a lot of people don't know about me, you know, that I don't think that is ever perceived, like on Facebook and social media, is that I don't talk a lot. I don't say a lot, because to me, Facebook and Instagram are only for entertainment purposes. What's for me is for me. What goes on in my private life is my private life. And the joys that I have, I share them. You know, I'm human. I go through things like everyone else. I'm just not the person that feels like that needs to be displayed for Facebook. But a lot of the things that I do are my choices. I don't have children, you know, so a lot of people are like, oh, you know, how does she do this or how does she do that? You know, I don't have the expense of children. I don't know if you knew this or not, I don't watch TV. I'm not a TV person at all.
Right.
So I'm usually, how I find out things are usually from being on social media, from the comments that people make. I truly 100% things that I like and the things that I do are genuinely from just me being out of the store and saying, hey, I like that purse, I like that bag. I may find out weeks later, like, that's the hottest bag out right now. But I don't watch TV. I don't even have cable. I couldn't even tell you. I don't really watch the news. When I do watch TV, or if I do catch TV, it's usually over someone else's house. And I'm more like a documentary type person. For the most part, I am just kind of robotic. Like, you know, I go to work, I come home, I work out. I have a circle of friends that I trust and I'm very close to, and I spend time with them, and I'm very close with my family. But outside of that, traveling and having fun, and anytime I can avoid driving, that's what I like to do, and taking care of myself and treating myself like a queen. And that means looking the part when I go out. I feel like confidence comes from within, and just feeling good about yourself all the way around the board. So that's really who I am as a person. And I hope that people don't take it any other way. You know, maybe the things that I post, but I do think that I work hard for the things that I have, and I enjoy life. And I love to get dressed up, and I love to go out, and I like to have my hair done. So like going out for me, is like going to the Grammys. I like to put me on like a little hot dress and go out, and half the time, you know, I'm not really doing much when I go out, but that's my thing, you know. And I love kids, so I'm always babysitting someone's kid, and I like doing that. So that's what Tiffany does, and I think it surprises people that I'm really that simple. But those are the small things that I do that keeps me like happy, you know.
Okay. One, a couple of quick questions for you. If you wasn't doing, well, let me put it this way. What other sport that you have not done that you would like to have? I have one in mind, but I'm going to let you answer the question first.
Okay, some sports that I haven't done. Okay.
That you want to
do. There's a sport that I want to get into.
Yes.
Okay, there's one sport that I want to do so bad. And I don't even know anything about it, hardly. I mean, I called it ultimate fighting, right? Mm-hmm. But they told me that it's called MMA. But because I don't watch TV, I've never seen an MMA fight, right? But I remember a long time ago when people were fighting the cages. I don't know if MMA is like that, or what they told me it's called MMA. I really want to go to somebody's gym that does MMA, and I want to ask them, like, how can I get involved in it and how can I do it? Because I think I'd be really good at it. And that's one sport that I really want to do. Another sport that I would like to do, I can't think of it right off right now. Hold on. No, that's pretty much it. Like, that's my main sport. There's some other things that I just want to do. That I'm going to do. But, like, that is a sport that people are like, you're going to do that? And they tell me that, like, their bodies get bruised up and stuff. But, like, I've never seen it. But, like, I just think I'd be good at MMA. So that's the one sport I want to do.
I've always had you as a boxer. I wanted you to get boxing.
So that's what people ask me to do. Someone asked me to do boxing. One thing about me is that, like, I've attempted boxing, and it's very disciplined. Like, I don't like that you gotta wait for that right punch. You know what I mean? You gotta keep waiting. I'm more impulsive, and I don't want to follow the rules. I just want to punch, you know, until, like, I punch them down. And what I learned is that I wasted a lot of energy trying to punch, and you get exhausted. So, you know, maybe that is something I may challenge myself and I may try to do, but I get totally impatient with the whole stepping and the this and the that. So that's when I said, look, I don't want to do this. Just give me MMA so I can just go bonkers on this person and just take them down. Like, that's what I want to do. So, I do have boxing gloves, and I do have a friend who does do boxing, and, like, I mean, I got so bored with the right hook, left hook, right punch. It didn't really excite me. Yeah, I just want to win. I just want to knock. I want to, you know, I remember the Mike Tyson days. I just want to knock him out in, like, 3 minutes, and then, like, 2 minutes, however it was, 30 seconds. And I don't think that's how boxing really goes. I think it's strategic, and I think you kind of have to plan it out. So I have a little bit of I gotta gain some more patience for that. But yeah, I'm open to trying that, you know. But MMA is my thing, Steven. That's what I want.
All right, not a problem. And I know why. I'm just gonna leave it alone. What?
MMA girl.
Yes, indeed. Yes, indeed. What's your favorite color?
I don't really have a favorite color. I like black, which is so traditional. I like pink, but I don't have one particular favorite color.
Okay. Favorite car? If you could have a car right now, what would you be driving?
Favorite car?
Yeah, that you do not mind driving if you had it.
Let me see. Oh.
Come on. Every woman has a favorite car.
I can't. You know what car that I love to drive, really like it? Favorite car? The four-door Porsche. I really like the way that car drives. Hmm. You know?
Have you driven it?
I like the whole thing.
Have you ever driven? I'm sorry, it's a second delay. Have you ever driven a Porsche?
Yes, I have. I have driven a Porsche. Yeah, and I liked it. And that's what I was trying to figure out. Like, which one did I like driving the best? But yeah, I like the way that car particularly drives. I've driven other exotic cars per se, but I like the way that one drives, and it's weird because I've driven more expensive cars, but I like that car. And a lot of people seem to like that car nowadays, so I like it. Yeah.
What is your favorite city in a city you would like to visit?
Oh, well, okay, my favorite city. Wow, that's hard.
Don't worry, I'll tell everybody in Martinsville you hate Martinsville.
I'm going to change the question up a little bit. This may not be my favorite city, but I've had the most fun in Vegas. You know, I like Vegas. When I say Vegas, it's not just the actual strip. I like the area of Red Rock. I like that place. One of the places that I want to visit is Dubai. And that's one of the places that I want to visit and that I want to go to.
Okay. Favorite food that you're crushing on?
Favorite food that I'm crushing on? All right, for everyone that's not from Martinsville, the closest thing to the favorite food that I'm crushing on, the closest thing that I can get to it is, I like the Italian sub from Quiznos, which I know everybody's like, oh my God, that's so fattening. But I love the Italian sub from Quiznos, but I have to take it from Quiznos because the original sandwich that I get that's the closest thing to that is from my hometown, this place called Fridays. And it's not TGI Fridays. It's not the franchise, the big franchise. It's just a small deli shop in my hometown, and it's called Fridays. And I like to get the number 9. It's a whole wheat sub, and it's like identical to the Quiznos sub. So the closest thing I can get to that is the Quiznos sub. But like that is one thing that I always try to get when I go home, and I miss it. Like I crush on that like majorly, like. I have been eating that since like it was in the Patrick Henry Mall, like when I was in first grade. And I pray that that man that owns that restaurant does not close it. Like, I love that. I love that sandwich.
Can you cook?
Yes, I can cook, surprisingly. I can cook. Okay. Now, what are you talking about? Are you talking about prep food?
Well, I know the prep food part, but can you cook? Like, so if you came down and if someone came and said, we're going to come to Tiffany's house and we're going to come eat a meal, are you a microwave queen or can you cook?
No, I'm not a microwave queen. And before I started competing, I never really ate bad anyway. So some of my favorite dishes that I like to cook, which I'm kind of simple. I'm a simple person. I kind of eat the same things over and over again. I love salmon. Like, I love salmon like no other. So salmon is a dish that I make. Even though I came from this very sweet town of Martinsville, Virginia, my mom has been a health fanatic ever since that I've been young. So a lot of typical Southern foods that most people would think that I would eat, I don't really like them. So yes, I can make macaroni and cheese. I don't really like macaroni and cheese. I don't eat sweet potatoes. I don't eat sweet potato pie. I don't eat potato salad. Can I make it? I can make anything that I can read. And the past people that ate my food, they liked it. I was engaged for I was in a relationship for like 3 years and we were engaged for like a year and a half. And I was the cooker for the house. I was the chef and there was no complaints there. So, I mean, they liked a wide variety of things from, I make great meatloaf. I've even fixed chitlins, I have to say. I don't eat those, but it was asked and requested for. So, I did that in greens and the sweet potato pie. But for the most part, yes, I can cook. My meals are usually things like I like spaghetti. but I get kind of creative with it. I'll use mushrooms instead of meat, or I use regular meat. I do meatloaf. I'm not a pork chop eater, but you know, I can fix pork chops. I don't really eat chicken wings or fried chicken. You know what I mean? That's just not my thing. You know, like that's not what I would pick up on a buffet, but yeah, I can fry chicken. Actually tonight I'm going to fry some zucchini actually. So yeah, I can definitely cook. I'm a very, one thing about me that I think all my coaches will say, I am a very fast learner and I'm a good student. So once I'm taught something, I'm good at repeating it. I don't try to go outside of what I was taught. And you know, I don't try to do extra. I'm a very good student and I listen. So I think that has a lot to do with me being successful in things. When someone tells me how to do something, I do it like I'm supposed to. Because I want the results to come out right. So I do that. And I do like to bake. Like, I like to bake. And I don't even like cakes and things like that. But I do bake and I give it away to people. Like, I give, like, it's this little boy that I babysit all the time. And he likes to eat my cookies and stuff. And I make cupcakes and I give them away. I don't know. I just like to bake, but I don't really care for cupcakes. But I do like brownies. So only brownies that are made from home.
You say you don't watch TV right now, but what would be, since you don't watch TV right now, what is your favorite TV show from for any time that you have watched TV?
It's so sad to say. I'm so old school. Like, I am so far behind on TV. The last TV show that I consistently watched was Sex and the City when I was in college.
Is that your favorite TV show?
That's how long ago that was. And that was, I'm sorry?
What was your favorite TV show of all time?
Those Thursday nights, The Cosby Show in a Different World. that's been the last time I've ever been glued to something where, like, you know, me, my mom, and the family, we were racing to get home on Thursday nights to see those two shows back, you know? And I can honestly say, you know, since that, there hasn't, you know, I never got with the TV show, I don't know if it was Living Single, and, you know, I never really got with any of that, you know, because I guess, I don't know, for one thing that I didn't share was that I go to bed very early. I'm a morning person. So usually by 9 o'clock, I'm usually dozing off or I'm already asleep. So, and before that, I'm preparing myself for the next day. So the TV shows that I do watch, if I get a chance to watch them, or if I go to someone's house and they have cable, I watch those documentaries, Snapped. I watch Snapped, which, you know, guys say, like, you're kind of crazy for watching that. But I watch Snapped. I love documentaries. And right now, if there's one channel that I could have at my house, and it was only one channel, it would be the OWN network. That's Oprah's network. I absolutely love, like, Ileana Fix My Life. I like her Super Soul Sundays. I just like those shows that she has. I don't know about any of the other ones, but I like those. And I guess that goes hand in hand with what I do for a living, you know, because I'm very therapeutic and I'm very always just trying to be better, you know, and trying to meet people where they are. So it's probably a good thing I don't have that channel all the time, because I probably get worn out with it. But that is what I would watch on TV. And I've tried to get into Scandal. I watched maybe 3 episodes of it when it first came on. Well, you know, after the hype was about it, I went back later after the first season and watched 3. And at first, I was upset. I was upset. Because my small morals and my morals from my hometown was very upset that this successful Black woman was having an affair. And I was thinking that all the young girls out here today are going to see that, like, think that it's okay to be someone's mistress. And I felt like they were not portraying the downside of being a mistress. Because, I mean, and like I said, I only saw, like, 3 episodes. And I just saw all the supposed good parts of it, her being a strong Black woman, you know, and the president's calling her. But, you know, they didn't show on Christmas that she was going to be alone, you know, and things like that. But then, too, I watched it again, and they did portray all sides of it, you know, and I felt differently about it. And I think I watched something on Oprah where I actually got to see the writer and the creator of the show and to find out that she was a Black woman, and then to actually read about the real Olivia Pope, because I'm more of a detailed person, you know, like I look deeper than just what it is. So it kind of makes it hard for me to kind of watch some things like that. But once I understood the whole basis of the whole show, I understood who wrote it, I celebrated. Like, I'm very happy for the lady that wrote it. I'm very excited that she's this successful on like a major network. And but like, as far as trying to catch that every night, that's not who I am. I'm not running home to sit in front of the TV at 10 o'clock because I can barely keep my eyes open at 10 o'clock. So, you know, I'm probably the person that, like, maybe if I go on vacation and, you know, if I can pull them up on demand, that's something I would do. I would try to catch them or whatever. But the last time I tried to look at it recently, it was starting to go a little too far. You know, the whole plane, you know, so now it's starting to go a little too far. So I think, you know, that probably won't be a show that I'm going to be hype about. But I'm glad that everyone else finds it exciting. And even though I don't try to watch it, I feel like I'm watching it on Facebook every Thursday.
I know what you mean. You're going to get that. A couple others. Your favorite movie?
That's another thing about me. Wow. I don't go to the movies very often. I don't watch movies. The last movie that I went to see was 12 Years a Slave, and I was tricked. I didn't know. I mean, I was already out with some people, and then they wanted to go see it, and that's how I got to see it. It was very, very hard to watch. It was very, I felt like I was sitting through a therapy session at my job, and I was having to hear, I mean, it was just torture after torture after torture. The movie was good. The point was taken, but it was heavy. You know, like, I was trying to have a light-filled day, and when after I saw that movie, it just, it weighed heavy on you when you left. You know, it just, it was pound for pound, like, definitely, definitely letting you know how it was. So, wonderful movie. Not what I would want to have done, like, in my free time on my weekend, was to be pounded by that. But the last movie that I enjoyed watching was Baggage Claim. It was like a little silly kind of like movie, I think, with Robin Thicke's wife. And that is the last movie that I saw. But I'm not a movie person. I am a team player. So, I mean, if the group is going, I will go. But I'm probably not the best person to take to the movies because I fall asleep in the movies at like 9. So the times that I did choose to go to the movies, it was 9:30 in the morning. And morning time is my time to shine. Between 6 a.m., well, yeah, 5:30 to 6 a.m., I mean, I am going like an Energizer Bunny. So those are my times. Like, I'm kind of opposite for most people. But I was taken to the movies to see Thor. That was my first time ever seeing Thor. Didn't know what Thor was. Not really into action, Marvel comic type stuff. But it actually was a lot better than what I thought. And like I said, life is about being open to things. And I did try it, and I had a good time. But 20 minutes into the movie, I started to doze off. I mean, not into the movie, as it was almost over.
Okay.
But I did better than,
Your favorite shoes?
My favorite shoes. I have lots of shoes, but I was just actually telling a girlfriend of mine at this modeling thing we just did, she had a pair of shoes that I had, and I told her, oh my God, I love those shoes. And they're just a plain black pair of a black set of heels that I bought from a store called Baker's. And they're just some stilettos. They're like 6-inch heels. And I actually have to say they're my favorite pair of shoes. I have several designer shoes, but you know, that day particularly, I was just saying, you know what? Those are my favorite, you know? So I don't know what the name, but I got it from the little store Baker's. Okay. I mean, I'm sure they didn't cost any more than $100, if that, but yeah, I love those shoes.
All right, last question. Since you're in the human services field and we see an uptake, and I kind of think it was already there, believe, like they always say, there's a rise in mental health problems in the US and we see it on the news. I feel like it's always been there. It's just that it's now getting the attention that it deserves. Unfortunately, for the wrong way, is getting the attention that it deserves. What can we do? And I know this is a loaded question, but what, in a couple of things, what would you do to help fix the social services field? And like, is it more money, more support, certain program that you've seen that think you think works well for most? What is it that you think that we need to do to fix it?
That's a very good question. And wow. I can honestly say, in Washington, D.C., in the metropolitan area, I can say that I feel like they are giving mental health all the attention that they need. I mean, you know, we can always take more, but I feel like in the District of Columbia, I mean, there is help for everything that you need. There's help for your light bill. There's help for housing. There's help for mental health especially. You know, housing is a little shortage, but mental health is there. And I always go back to my hometown. You know, I feel like it's the smaller areas, the areas there that they need the help with the mental health. You know, the core services agencies that will allow for individual therapy. You know, I know in our hometown it's small, and I know we have one facility, you know, that does that, you know, but in smaller towns, there's stigmas that go along with, you know, mental health that people don't want to own up to. And being in a larger city, you hear more people talk about, I'm schizophrenic, I'm bipolar, I suffer from depression. And, you know, and people are not embarrassed. They're not embarrassed to walk into the doors. They're okay with it. So I feel like the help is there here. I feel bad for those other small areas where everyone is so conservative to look a certain way. But deep down, not everyone, but in a lot of families, they're dealing with substance abuse and they keep it quiet because they don't want the neighbors to know. They're dealing with severe depression. They don't want the neighbors to know about. So to answer your question, I think the help is here. And one of the things I know you spoke on, two things recently that happened in the District of Columbia, the Navy shooting. Actually, one of my employees is a veteran, and he shared with me that the guy at the Navy Yard was actually on his team, kind of like, I guess they get split up in teams when they go get services from the vet hospital for their medical stuff. And the thing is that mental health is real. I think that he was getting the help that he was getting, but mental health is always tricky. And I work in it every day, and I work with people that are schizophrenic and have several different disorders, panic attacks. And the thing is that it's an ongoing cycle. You know, we can provide them with the services, we can provide them with the meds, but not all. It could be just a slight thing of not taking your meds for 3 weeks, you know, and then you have that breakdown. And that breakdown is you hearing those voices that are telling you that, you know, the enemies are about to attack. I have to protect these people. Let me shoot them. So I feel like the major cities are doing what they can. And I think, you know, it's real. And there's several agencies out here. They may not be the best, but it's a start. I worry a lot about my hometown. I worry a lot about the drug use that goes on in my hometown, with people trying to self-medicate themselves, and the stigma that comes along with it. But like I say, you know, even counselors have to have counselors, because who counsels the counselor? You know, everybody has to have somebody to dump off the stressors in life. Life isn't perfect. Some things that we have are hereditary. You is that I also deal with the whole side of the clientele who are in recovery and they have substance abuse. So it makes me go back to think, in my hometown, we have recovery meetings, we have NA and AA, but because we're such a small, town, and because there's a lot of judgment, and people do tell people's business, I don't think that what you can have an NA or AA meeting somewhere else, you can always get from our small town, because if you do want to go into a meeting and share that, you know what, I just smoked a lot of drugs and, you know, I want to start over today, you know, that's probably going to be told to 10 other people, like within our hometown, and people are going to know. So I really, my heart really goes out to people in my hometown that are suffering with substance abuse and mental health abuse. I mean, I'm sorry, mental health issues, that work decent jobs and don't want to go over to the public place to get public mental health treatment because maybe they can't afford to. I mean, the last time I checked, I mean, and things may have changed. I think we had one psychiatrist there, and I don't know who did therapy. Maybe you had someone there who did therapy, but you had to pay out of your pocket for that. Other than that, you know, you were subject to that lays on my heart pretty heavy. So I do think I had a conversation or a meeting with a group of my clients, and what I shared with them was that I try to keep them informed that welfare will not always be here. You know, they're slowly taking away all these things, and you need to empower yourself, be independent. You know, get educated. You know, you can't depend on, you know, getting welfare all the time. And one of my clients raised their hand and they said to me, you know, what, they take it away from us, what are we gonna do? And I really had to take them back and I had to say, you know, I'm from a very small town and I can almost bet you that I can name at least four people that can't read or write, but they go to a job every day. You know, I can name people that may not be able to read or write, but they find something to do to And you know what I told them was that if that was to happen to you and they were to take away your benefits and you were not able to get it, you would figure out how to survive too, you know. So it's only when the situation happens we'll figure it out. But yes, mental health is very important, and I think the more that we make just regular bystanders and regular people aware of mental health, I think it can help things as a whole.
Good. Yep. Keep your stomach tight.
I want to thank you very kindly, Miss Tiffany Lynch, for joining us with Enliven Radio, part of Legacy Internet Radio, and I appreciate everything. It's going to definitely help us a lot, and not only just us, but you know, a lot of young men and women out there, especially young girls of a good, positive woman that's out there working hard, and we're going to change the world, and we're going to start one day at a time, especially with wonderful people like you. I wanted to say thank you for the interview.
Thank you.
No problem.
Thank you for having me. Right. I really appreciate it. You're doing great things, Aussie, with your radio station.
Thank you.
And there you
go. I'm trying. I'm just trying to do what I can to help others and just make things happen. So I want to thank everybody out there for watching the video part of Enliven Radio of our Empowered Women series. And oh, by the way, Miss Lynch, do you have a website for people to follow you or questions and things like that? How can they contact Miss Tiffany Lynch?
All right. right. I'm not so good with this. Let's see. My Instagram, to follow me on Instagram or contact me there, my Instagram is Lynch Tiffany. That's LynchTiffany. That's my Instagram. My Facebook, I think is the same thing. Let me make sure this is right. It's Tiffany Lynch. Is that all you give? Is that just the screen name, or do you give the email address?
No, you give your screen name, I guess.
I'm not really familiar with how to find people on Facebook, but on, okay, my screen name for Facebook is Tiffany Lynch. It's TiffanyLynchIFPA Pro. So it's Tiffany Lynch, IFPA Pro. That's my Instagram, and that's my Facebook. And I do have Twitter. My Twitter account is at Tiffany Lynch. So everything has my name in it. They all have pictures of me on there. My email address is lynchtiffany2008@gmail.com. If you have any questions about fitness or jumping into bodybuilding or any questions like that, I will answer anything that that I can help you with. And if I can't help you with it, I'll definitely put you in the direction to speak to someone that can help you in that area. Just try to always pay it forward.
All right. I thank you very kindly. And everybody, thank you and Live and Radio for listening to us. And we appreciate you very much. And we'll see you at our next Empowered series.
I got you.